boy Johnny, and I am down here with a nice cup of roasted coffee, and I am with my dear friends, Rabbi Mike and Matthew Miller, and
Paul Kennedy. Oh yeah! All right. Oh yeah, baby.
And we are down here, and we are
live, and we are in your ear. Oh yeah! Oh yeah! Oh yeah, baby. Oh yeah. We're down here. We're down here for Iron Show Live. We are live, and we are in your ear. Tonight we are very honored to have a fantastic group of people here around us tonight. We have Rabbi Michael Bug, author of the book When the Stars Fall, and Matthew Miller of the End Time Tribune, and from out on the highways and byways in his 50 million wheeler semi-truck. At the moment, we have with us our Iron Show truck driving, co-hosting human being, big monster, man of 1,000 men, Paul Kennedy. What's up, Paul? We're down here for some live iron. We are continuing our studies in the Book of Esther, finding hidden prophecies where no man or very few men have thought to look. And, you know, we are down here, and let's see here. Rabbi Mike, do you remember, actually, before we get going into this, last week I announced that our dear friend Matthew Miller had fallen on hard times, baby, hard times. And I would just like to thank everybody who helped him out. Matthew Miller is getting back on his feet. And I checked my post office box. You know that during this whole month of March, I am on a campaign, and I am on a mission to get Matthew Miller back on his feet. We'll give him a leg up. Because Matthew Miller is not buying a new gold front door for his cathedral. he is not buying, he does not need the money to buy, a golden faucet and golden knobs for his bathroom vanity. No. No, Matthew Miller, if you help him out, right here, you're going to really be helping a brother in Christ in a real mission of love, because you're going to basically get him going back again and set him up with basic needs. So every dollar that you send in here if you go to PayPal and send some money to the End Time Tribune or just End Time Tribune, you could do that. The best way, I think, is to go to www.endtimetribune.com. You got to have the W's in there. That's www.endtimetribune.com. Once again, that's www.endtimetribune.com. All you right at the top of the page there, you'll have a donate button. You just click that baby and send Matthew Miller a few bucks. You know, every dollar will go to actual help for a human being, and for the month of March, against Matthew Miller's wishes, Johnny is on a campaign to give him a leg up, and I would like to call all the brothers and sisters out there to reach in your pocket, dig deep, my friends, and just send Matthew Miller a few bucks. What are you going to do when you're standing in front of the Lord and you're saying, well, I didn't give Matthew Miller a few bucks because I wanted to buy season 3 of American Idol. Yeah, that's going to fly. That's going to look real good when you're at the judgment. All right. You know, another way, if you don't like using your money on the internet, don't like using cards on the internet, you can simply send a little bit of cash or a little bit of or a check or money order to me, and I'll forward it to Matthew Miller. That's John McMahon, P.O. Box 2026. That's John McMahon, P.O. Box 2026, Beaverton, Oregon 97075. That's just like the beaver, because Oregon is the beaver state. You know, we have a football team known as the Beavers. So that's, once again, you can just send a little bit of cash, a little check, money order, and I'll forward that to Matthew Miller, too. John McMahon, P.O. Box 2026, Beaverton, Oregon 97075. All right, and you know, I went to check the mailbox today, the post office box today on my lunch, and I was so humbled and just about in tears that really people had actually gone to the trouble of sitting down, writing out a few checks, you know, you know, writing some letters, and some of them kind of touched my heart here. I'd like to thank Rick and Carol for their donation, and I'd like to just kind of read their letter just real quick. Johnny, we heard you were talking about Matthew Miller needing a little help right now. We would like to help him by giving him a small amount of money, but also, and it wasn't all that small, actually, to tell you the truth. It was a pretty good donation. But also let him know that we are praying that God will bless him and his family, and that's my prayer too, by the way. We also would like to tell you how much we enjoy the Iron Show. Your show is fun, but your humble spirit and love for God comes shining through. Our journey into Fringe Christian Radio started a few years ago. We were both raised in the church, but we weren't getting the answers to many of our questions about life and the strange things happening in today's world. Boy, amen. We're all there, huh? We've all been there. Anyway, we started listening to a lot of paranormal shows. They didn't have the answers, really, and just led to more questions. Boy, I hear you there, buddy. Then we heard L.A. Marzulli on a show called Beyond the Edge. That's an old one, too. This is going back a few years with Eric Altman. We were so amazed. L.A. really had answers that we were looking for. We started listening to Acceleration Radio, which, by the way, Acceleration Radio is the show that's on just before the Iron Show on this same Fringe Radio Network. That's FringeRadioNetwork.com. And anyway, that led us to a show called Future Quake. Dr. Future, Johnny loves you, buddy. You know that. Me and Dr. Future are tight. Anyway, yeah, we go back years. Dr. Future, he made the Iron Show. But anyway, that's where we first heard you. Now it would be hard to list all the Fringe Christian shows that we listen to. We started studying the Bible again. Thank God, you know, hey. And can proudly say that we are children of the one true God. Praise the Lord. By the way, putting Matthew Miller and Rabbi Mike together was really an inspiration. We are getting so much from their study of Esther. God bless you. All right. Thank you, Rick and Carol. Oh, man. What do you think of that, guys?
Amen. Good stuff.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
All right. Yeah, I was so amazed to find a mailbox full of donations and wonderful letters from, you know, the listeners out there. I just wanted to thank Rick and Carol. I want to thank another guy named Rick. He's really helped out a lot. This Rick. I'm not going to give last names because that's not cool, but this Rick really gave from, basically he gave from his poverty, and he really gave his last 20 bucks. And, you know, I would give Matthew Miller my last 20 bucks myself because I love him, and, he has truly been a blessing to all of us. He's never asked for anything. All he's done is devote himself to service to all the people out there. And he has just been a slave for Jesus. And helping him out right now is about 1/100th of what he really has coming with what he deserves, if you ask me. But anyway, for the month of March, I want to continue to help out Matthew Miller. I know it's enough of that. I just wanted to thank Travis also. And... I wanted to thank, I wanted to thank 1870. You know, 1870, you know, we got an aircraft mechanic out there who gave Matthew Miller a donation in cash, and you can literally tell he reached in his pocket and pulled out everything he had in his pocket, stuffed it in an envelope. Oh, that is really something. I pulled up the envelope. I'm like, wow. It's like it came right out of his pocket, you know, kind of wadded up and stuff. He just dumped it. He just gave you everything he had right there. And I'd also like to thank, Pamela. Thank you very much, Pamela. Very generous donation. Johnny is very much in your debt. I want to thank all of you. I want to thank all of you who are planning to send a donation. I want to thank everybody who is going to go on PayPal. And I, God bless everybody, all the listeners. I'm so honored to be here in your ear. It really is an honor. Isn't it, Matthew? Isn't it an honor to be in their ear?
Yes, it is. It's quite an honor to be good for something today. It is quite an honor to be blessed by those that have contributed. And may I say this with my own mouth and the authority that my own Father in heaven has given me, that may it be returned upon your heads 10,000-fold. May he remember you, and may he protect you and provide for you long after he's done with me. I have been honored beyond what my mouth can utter words. It is truly a blessing to know that the good Lord's children are mindful about their family members. That is truly a sign of hope in the days that we're in right now. And I don't know how else to put it. May the good Lord repay everything that you have done for me 10,000-fold.
You know, Johnny here, when you talk about, like, advanced theology, you know, sometimes Johnny thinks about advanced theology, and I know that there's two concepts that are involved with advanced theology, and the first is monergy, and the second is synergy. And monergists believe that God is responsible for every single little move, and we have no say in the matter. And those would include hyper Calvinists and people like that, and other types of theology also would come under monergy. Then we have synergy, where we have God working, and then we have us making choices and doing works. And in combination, God's will is done. And I would like to tell everybody that, at least for now, I am definitely a synergist. Now, I don't know when it comes to salvation. I don't even understand that concept very well, you know, how that works. But as far as doing works and helping out our brethren, I really believe that, you know, it's not just God that gets, you know, the credit. I mean, the people, God's people, you know, they're out there making choices. They're out there, well, they're out there giving a rat's furry little bottom. So I'd like to, you know, thank everybody for caring, you know, and prayer, you know, there's nothing more powerful than prayer either, you know. For those of you who bother to get on your knees, you know, there's nothing more powerful than that. Am I lying to you, Rabbi Mike?
You are not lying at all. Exactly right. And here's the deal. You know, salvation is by faith, but when someone truly walks with God, okay, not just, you know, has made an affirmation, but you're truly walking with God, he delights in the prayers of the righteous. Okay? So for all of you out there that are praying, and all of you out here there who are part of the spiritual war we find ourselves in, remember, the adversary's strategy is to get you into some sin. So you are drawn away from God. It's not that God moves, it's that you move. So your prayers are not heard as readily. So as you're praying, remember, always repent, always turn back to God, not just in words, but actually turning away from whatever in your life is a stumbling block and drawing ever closer to the Most High.
Amen. Wow. A moment of silence on the Iron Show.
for deep thought. You know, that's what Selah means, you know, in the Hebrew, right? It means pause and reflect.
Exactly.
No, I completely disagree with you. It means, what's up?
What's up? Oh, yeah, but that's not good enough unless we have a little, and we are in your ear.
I actually think Selah is Hebrew for insert guitar riff here. You know, it's like you get to the end of the line, then you just rip off from that really, really awesome guitar riff that just sort of leaves the last words you said hanging there while everyone's like really into the music.
Cool. That's like, you know, that's like better than anything I thought of. That's great.
Well, it was interesting. It's like, you know, in the synagogue liturgy, we our prayers are basically strung together segments of scripture, and every now and then you get to that Selah, but you haven't, synagogues don't really have instrumental music in combination with the prayer because that was something that was done in the days of the temple, and therefore, you know, we do canting, which is somewhere between singing and chanting. And I'm just like, you know, I'm really looking forward to the day when the temple's rebuilt and everything's made right again, and we once again have instrumental music as we're saying our prayers to the Most High, and then we get to the Selah, and instead of just reading Selah, somebody just goes off on a guitar or whatever. really make it the way it was in the days of David, you know?
I wonder, yeah, that's like what happened when they did when they came to the Selah, like David ripped off on a couple solos.
Breaks out his lyre.
Cool. Yeah, you got to remember that, you know, the Psalms, I would sure like to have heard them, you know, in their original form when they had, you know, the original, because they played music. I mean, that big. They had like an orchestra while they did those Psalms back then. Am I lying or am I wrong?
And that's one of the reasons why you'll notice, like in the New Testament, there are quite a few places where the apostles could have quoted something from Isaiah or something like that for the Messianic prophecy. But if they can find it, they always like to quote the Psalms because everyone had them memorized. You know, people might not know something obscure in Malachi or Micah. I remember that Herod had to send out for the experts to find out where the Messiah was supposed to be born. But everyone knew the Psalms. So, you know, whenever they could quote the Psalms as Messianic prophecy, they were like right there because they knew, you know, they could quote one little line, and pretty soon everyone's just singing on together, and everyone knows exactly what the rest of the context is.
Wow. So it really, you know, a lot of those Psalms, if you could hear them in their original form, they would hit you with different new kinds of revelation, probably, wouldn't they?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. As a matter of fact, a lot of them head off with, it says two, and then, you know, some phrase or whatever, and it's probably referring to a well-known a tune, you know, kind of like Amazing Grace, at least in as the story goes, was originally done to the tune of a drinking song that was well known, and therefore it was easy to get into that. And David was all the time taking like other songs that he liked the tune to and then rewriting the lyrics to praise God even more. And I always thought that was really neat. I really would love to hear what those songs were, because I bet you anything that would add whole new levels of meaning to the words that we find in the text.
Are there any kind of forms of sheet music from those ancient times extant in these days?
Sadly, no. As a matter of fact, we're not even 100% sure that they used any kind of sheet music. They may well have had a musical notation, but none of it has survived. Like I said, in mainline Judaism, there has been no real use of instrumental music in worship for 2,000 years. When the temple was destroyed, basically all of Judaism went into mourning, and therefore, you know, while there's no problem with, you know, a fiddler on the roof, in terms of the worship service, you don't have much in the way of instrumental music at all. It's all what's called canting, which, like I said, is somewhere in a middle ground between singing and chanting, and which is beautiful in its own right, but you don't have a harp playing in the background or anything like that. It's all the human voice that carries it. And I'm pretty sure that, I mean, as much as I'd like to think that all the tunes have been carried over the centuries, I'm fairly sure that they've been adapted and shifted slightly over time. That's just the way those things go.
Yes, perhaps the theme to the Iron Show, Johnny Rainbow, perhaps God actually imparted some of the original psalm music into that.
All right. So we just need to find the psalm that starts with what's up.
what's up? Oh, yeah, baby. We were in our journey through the Book of Esther, and we're really taking it apart, and we're kind of going verse by verse. And I think we had Matthew Miller reading us a verse with Rabbi giving commentary, and then Rabbi Mike reading a verse with Matthew Miller giving commentary, with me and Paul Kennedy sticking in strange questions. So, do you remember where we left off in our last, this is part three for those of you who are just tuning in or just downloaded this one session. It would be a must for you to go back and listen to Iron Show 7 and 8. Which would be part one, part two, and we're now on part three. This is Iron Show Live, I should say. Excuse me, Iron Show Live 7, Iron Show Live 8, and now we are on Iron Show Live 9. And we're live, and we are in your ear. Rabbi Mike, you are the one who has taken the notes. You've made the marks. Where are we in the Book of Esther?
All right, tell me out here, Matthew. I know we were coming up on chapter 3, but did we get to – I don't think we quite got to verse 21. Did we go through 21 through 23 yet?
Yes,
we did. Because I seem to recall – we did? Okay.
Yes, we actually finished it up.
That's right. Because I commented on the when it says gallows, it actually – the literal meaning is tree, and I brought in the fact that the Persians had were actually the ones that invented crucifixion. So, yeah, okay, that makes sense then. I'd actually forgotten to make my little hash mark at the end of the last week, so I was not 100% sure if we had finished the chapter there. So, why don't you take it from there, Matthew? I've already, started dominating accidentally here, so, fire away. I'll ride along and jump in when at the end of each stanza along with you.
All right, well, let's go ahead and take the first stanza, which is the first six verses. This is where things get interesting. Mm-hmm. This is where the bad intentions become manifest. Esther chapter 3, very first verse. After these events, Ahasuerus promoted Haman, the son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, and advanced him and established his authority over all the princes who were with him. All the king's servants who were at the king's gate bowed down and paid homage to Haman, for so the king had commanded concerning him. But Mordecai neither bowed down nor paid homage. Then the king's servants, who were at the king's gate, said to Mordecai, "Why are you transgressing the king's command?" Now, it was, when they had spoken daily to him, and he would not listen to them, that they told Haman to see whether Mordecai's reason would stand, for he had told them that he was a Jew. When Haman saw that Mordecai neither bowed down nor paid homage to him, Haman was filled with rage. But he disdained to lay hands on Mordecai alone, for they had told him who the people of Mordecai were. Therefore Haman sought to destroy all the Jews, the people of Mordecai, who were throughout the whole kingdom of Ahasuerus.
Alrighty. Well, let's see. I mean, we've talked about sort of our overview of this, and so far we're on fairly much the same page. Mordecai is very much a messianic figure. Esther is to a certain extent, but she also seems to represent the bride in certain respects here. King Ahasuerus, for all the fact that he was a bit of a jerk in real life, he nevertheless, as king of the whole world, represents the Holy One of Israel, and the creator and king of the whole world. And now we come to Haman, whose name, if you go and you look at like a strong stomach, I'll just say, well, names of foreign derivation, but it's interesting in Hebrew, Haman means to disturb, to cause a commotion, which is definitely what he does here. You could also play a little bit of a pun here, because you could also pronounce it as Hamin. A mean is one who divides or a heretic. So even though his name is certainly of Persian origin, there are nevertheless, even in the Hebrew, there's the right up at the front, the very instant you get to his name, there's the hints of, you know, just how much of an enemy he's going to become. And that's driven home when we find out that he's an Agagite, a descendant of King Agag, who Saul was supposed to put to death in 1 Samuel 15, and Saul let himself be bribed. And Samuel came along and had to finish the job, and that's when Saul lost God's favor. And there's a, while the text is not explicit on this, the old rabbinic legend is that the delay allowed King Agag's wife and one of his sons to escape, and they basically fled. And eventually, we have this encounter between this descendant of the tribe of Benjamin, the same tribe that Saul came from, and of King Agag, whom Saul almost wiped out. And here we actually see the wisdom. You know, just in a plain text sense, we see the wisdom where God tells Israel that, you know, when they go up against certain enemies, when they are up against, that they are to fight a total war and end the war then. There are actually numerous places where Joshua is told to put to death every man, woman, and child of certain cities, and that seems pretty harsh. But here we see an example of what happens when the war is not brought to a complete end, when enemies are allowed to continue. The war just continues a few hundred years later. And so what we're really seeing here is Mordecai from the tribe of Benjamin, possibly even of King Saul's line, although we don't really have much evidence for that, finishing the job that should have been finished several hundred years, I think at this point about 500 or 600 years before that.
I would like to just note, just really quickly, that I see in Mordecai, I see like a Daniel figure where he refuses to bow to the, you know, to the king's, basically what, it's basically idolatry. I mean, it's the majesty in the kingdom, you know, to bow to the king, but it's really put, the way it's read, it's more like bowing to a system.
That's true, and there's actually a debate, because the Bible doesn't actually forbid us to bow to a king. You actually see it all the time. The problem in the Bible is not with bowing to a living king who is God's representative authority on the earth. It's with bowing to an idol, something we've made with our own hands. We can get into the reasons for that if you'd like, but the rabbis are actually there's some discussion about, okay, why did Mordecai refuse to bow? One theory is that Haman had declared himself to be divine, and therefore Mordecai would not bow to him. Another is that Haman's robes were decorated with idols, and therefore to bow to Haman would be to bow to these idols, and so Mordecai refused. I tend to think, though, that it's entirely possible that that Mordecai may well have been a descendant of King Saul, and if he knew Haman's origins, to bow to this Agagite would have been to bow to Amalek, the first enemy Israel faced coming out of Egypt, because Amalek was a raider who attacked the flanks of Israel right after we crossed the Red Sea. And Agag came from that line. So to bow to Haman would be like saying that Amalek won, in a sense. And I really suspect that has more to do with it than with, you know, any particular appearance of his robes or anything like that.
I also I jumped all over, walked all over Matthew Miller. He was about to speak. Can you remember what you were thinking at the time, Matthew?
Oh yes, I can certainly remember. As a matter of fact, my old pastor made sure I wouldn't forget. This is something that Brother Marshall brought to my attention, and I missed the jot and the tittle on this one. So I remember this stanza quite clearly. Ladies and gentlemen, there's some funny things going on here with this proclamation inside the Hebrew. What you see in the Strong's Concordance is H559, but that's not how it is at all in the Masoretic text. It's really that word twice stacked up on top of each other, and both times it's spelled quite a bit differently. Now, understand that in a miraculous, most miraculous way, this verse here, Esther chapter 3, verse 4, it'll take you to 10 different questions.
Pardon me, Matthew, which word are you referring to that the Strong's is referring to?
559.
Right, right. But which word in the plain text? Which word is it translating?
Now, it came to pass as they spake.
Okay.
That right there.
Verse 4. Okay, got it.
Right, verse 4.
Okay.
Because what they were doing there actually was reading a proclamation. So they had a mm-hmm. scroll in front of them, and they were reading it out loud. That's why it's here that way right. in this text. Now, the first spelling of it, it only occurs one other time in the Masoretic text, and that is Psalms 42, verse 10. And everybody take note that when you go there, you're going to find 9 questions. And those 9 questions are comparable to the testing of the Lord's servant. Very important indeed. And the next one, well, it is no it's would be a no small measure for the reason why I didn't catch this one. But the second form of that word actually carries a feminine aspect to it. And when you get the Hebrew translation of the New Testament, let me say that one more time. Most people don't ever look at this. I've had a copy since I was 15. It's a Hebrew copy of the New Testament. And that word, that second part there, that carries the feminine aspects, that lands you right smack dab in the middle of 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 10. And when you go there, the reason why it's stated as such is because, remember, they were talking about Paul in a very bad light. This is the verse. For his letters, they say, are weighty and powerful, but his bodily presence is weak, and his speech contemptible. Here, it carries that feminine aspect, and the question involved is just 3 simple verses before it. Do ye look on things after the outward appearance? So take note that both Psalms chapter 42, it has 9 questions in it, questions which you will certainly be tested in, should you be tested in the future. And the 10th one is there in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. You might want to take a look at those for insights into your time of testing. You might want to consider that. Because these things going on in this text, it only occurs here. It doesn't occur anywhere else. Now, it's pretty obvious why I didn't catch the second one. But you understand why in the Hebrew translation of the New Testament, it has to carry that feminine aspect, because they were actually calling him, well, weak. They were actually calling him a, well, Johnny would say sissy, perhaps. But this is it's very important indeed, and I want to push it to everybody. I know that you don't have time, but understand that God here has quite miraculously encoded for you a way that you will know exactly what's going on. Now, back to that first part. It is earlier in Esther, and it's in exactly the wrong spot where you don't want it to be. It's in the very bad spot for, well, Vashti, because the only other time it's in the scripture is Esther 1:17, of course, when Ahasuerus commanded Vashti to come, and she did not. So putting that all together in a miraculous way that this has been done, it's encoded to you that your time of testing will come, but he has told you full well 10 different questions, and the forms of those questions are beyond any shadow of a doubt how you're going to be tested, because that's what Psalms 42 is about, actually. And that is what 2 Corinthians chapter 10 is about. So this is a marvelous and miraculous piece of scripture that we're looking at here. And prophetically speaking, encoded right here in that phrase. Encoded right there. Stacked up on top of one another.
On that one, Matt.
Excuse me?
I said my keep is off to you. My yarmulke is off to them. My hat's off to you, if you will, on that one. Because I, in my art scroll here, it actually had the kere, where it's read as if it said cum rum, but in fact the text says bomb rum. And I was wondering, I was playing around looking at, okay, how would that change me in the text? I didn't think to go and dig up all the other places where it appears in the actual original form with the bait starting instead of the chet, or not the chet, the chaf. And so that, thank you very much. I was actually wondering that as I was reading this. I figured you would have something cool that you pulled out of that. That's awesome.
Well, you don't owe your thanks to me. You owe your thanks to a much better man than me. Brother Marshall was, well, I'm pretty sure that he didn't get outside of 10 feet from the presence of the Lord his God. and he sure taught my knuckles to be be ever mindful of every little jot and tittle. So you owe your thanks to him.
Well, you learned your lessons well, and you've shared that with us today. So thank you for being such a diligent student, even if you come from a better master. I think all of us stand on the shoulders of giants when we discover these jots and tittles here. But you definitely have learned your lessons, and I appreciate that a lot.
Well, you're welcome.
You can never run out of discoveries in the scriptures, can you?
No, you can't.
No. No, we could stay here in Esther forever and never get down to the bottom of the barrel.
Oh, because pick it any is, book.
Exactly. Any book, any chapter. It is the living word. It is something that is way beyond our comprehension.
Amen.
And that's good. Amen. That's good. I mean, it's nice to know. I mean, just on a shallow level, it's nice to know that we will never come to the end of our discovery. Even if we lived 1,000 lifetimes, we still would not know everything there is to know about the scripture, about the word of God, would we?
No. And I have to admit, this is where I get a little bit frustrated with some of the resources available. It's like I've got here, it was a graduation gift when I finished yeshiva, an art scroll, a copy of the Tanakh, and I've got the English on one side and the Hebrew on the other, because the rabbis consider it important that, you know, even if you're not an expert in the Hebrew world, you read straight Hebrew, that it should be there available for you to delve into as you improve. And I went out looking for the equivalent in the New Testament, where I could have the English on one side but the Greek on the other, and could not find it. I actually wrote a guy who runs a blog where he reviews various Bibles and stuff, and he told me, you're not going to find what you're looking for. You can find them in straight Greek, you can find them in straight English, but you're not going to find – there are very few just New Testaments, and you're not going to find it with like the English and the Greek there. I'm like, why not? Because – if you're going to get into the jots and tittles, you have to have the original text there to explore. Otherwise, you are never getting past the translation. So,
I have one of those. I actually have one of those. It was really, really hard to. Yeah, it was really, really hard to find. Took me a couple years of searching. But yeah,
email me the name and the edition, because okay. I would willingly search that out if I could find something like that.
Okay.
Awesome.
You're I'm talking sorry, Matthew, about just a...
I interrupted you there. Please continue.
Yeah.
Now, we're ready for Paul to chime in here. We're ready for the next stanza. Paul, do you have anything you want to add, bud?
It looks like he dropped off on my Skype.
Actually, Paul told me earlier while we were talking that he is in the middle of dealing with the police. So... Yes, he's in his semi truck on the highway, and there's like a kind of a jam up, hold up, accident type thing. He's dealing. He goes up. I got to go deal with the police. Maybe I'll catch you guys in a while. All right.
Is he in any kind of trouble?
Yeah. Well, you know, he ran over a small family, and spread them on the pavement like butter on toast. And now they're asking him questions.
Family, no, you can't hold him to blame for that.
Right? No, he was just stuck in traffic, and for some reason, it was like an accident, and he like saw it, and he had to talk to him about it. But it's nothing of Paul's doing, no.
Okay.
No.
Okay. I was just wondering if we should pause here and offer up a word of prayer for him. But if he's helping someone else out, that's, you know, much better than what I was thinking for a second.
I'm not really sure, but that's the gist that I got from it, you know. So, okay. Yes. Anyway, why don't we just keep going in the scripture, and I think it's Rabbi Mike's turn to read.
Okay. Let's see here. Before I continue, I wanted to just bring in a point, and I think I mentioned this last week or week before, but I think it's really key to understand the prophetic point on here, and that's this moment where Mordecai refuses to bow down to Haman.
Yeah.
He refuses to bow down to the disturber here. And that very much is paralleled in the New Testament, where Yeshua, Jesus, is in his 40-day temptation in the wilderness. You remember what that
– oh, yeah.
You know, you had the three temptations, and it's – between Matthew and Luke, there's a little bit of a question about exactly what order they happened in. But the climax temptation, in my mind, is where the adversary takes him on top of a high mountain, shows him all the kingdoms of the world, and says, "This has all been delivered to me. I will give it to you if you will just bow down and worship me." And Yeshua refuses, saying, "No, it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God only."
You know, Chris White, I like Chris White, but he was doing a study on this, and he was basically saying, at least I think it was Chris White, he was saying that it wasn't that, or maybe it was you, Rabbi Mike, who told me this, but it wasn't like Satan was offering Jesus the kingdoms of the world so that, like, you know, he could in a big way enjoy the pleasures of Egypt, as it were. But he was saying, but rather, he was actually saying, "Look, you know, you can get your job done through me. You don't have to go up on the cross."
I agree with him on that. Because in Satan's mind, everything's about the power. Okay, I think it was Dr. Ed Murphy who wrote that all occultism is a power game. In Satan's mind, everything is about power, and so he's looking at, here's the Messiah that's been risen up. He has some inkling of the prophecies, although I don't think he had a full view of them. But in his mind, well, okay, this is the son of David. He's supposed to rise to power over Israel and then rise to power over the whole world. I know that he's going to suffer somehow in there. What if I offer him a way to achieve that same power without the suffering?
Right.
And, you know, and the thing is, it's kind of fascinating because Yeshua doesn't say, "Well, you can't do that. You don't have that power." Indeed, the adversary could, because, as Dr. Heiser puts out with his divine counsel paradigm, the adversary has control over the nations of the world through his agents, these archangels, gods, whatever you want to call them, who report to him, and therefore he could turn it over. As a matter of fact, Revelation chapter 13 tells us one day he will turn it over to a man who accepts his offer.
Right. And for some unknown reason, God has given him that power for a short time.
Exactly. And when Yeshua turns him down, it says, then Satan withdrew from him and waited for an opportune time. And if you look at what happens there, the adversary goes from trying to tempt them to trying to kill him. And in the same way, right here, we see Mordecai refuses to bow down to Haman, or Haman, as he's showing off here. And so Haman, when he finds out that Mordecai won't bow down to him, he wants to destroy Mordecai. But he doesn't want to only destroy Mordecai. He wants to destroy the entire Jewish people, and that's where we want to focus in on for a second here, because when you look at, for example, Revelation chapter 12, you've got the woman dressed in, you know, with twelve stars around her head, representing the 12 tribes of Israel, clothed in the sun, standing on the moon. Interesting that, by the way, but she's in labor, getting ready to give birth, and the dragon wants to devour her son.
Oh, yeah.
But the son is caught up to heaven before the dragon can devour him. So what does he do? He turns and attacks the woman. In the same way, Mordecai would not bow down to Haman. Does he simply, you know, when Mordecai, you know, he's like, okay, I could kill Mordecai, but that's not really getting victory over him. So it's not enough for me to kill him. I've got to kill the whole people. It's the exact same tactic.
Including Esther,
played out in Haman,
the woman.
And the adversary.
Including Esther, the woman.
Well, he doesn't know about Esther yet.
Ah, he doesn't. Oh, okay. Well,
and Esther, well, and remember, there's an interesting thing in Revelation 12. First, the dragon tries to devour the man-child, the Messiah. Then, when he can't touch him, he goes after the woman.
Right.
She is given escape to a place in the wilderness, which is called her place. And he tries to destroy her with a flood, which can symbolize a flood of armies, a flood of men and military force. The very earth or the very land, it can be translated both ways, devours those armies coming against her. So when he realizes he can't destroy the woman, he turns and attacks the rest of her children, those who keep the commandments of God and the testimony of Yeshua. Okay. In the same way, we're going to see here that Haman goes and he first tries to attack Mordecai by getting Mordecai to bow to him. Mordecai refuses. So then he attacks the whole Jewish people, just like Satan attacks the woman that represents Israel. And in the end, it is Esther. And that you could find a parallel with in Revelation 12, the rest of the woman's children who keep the commandments of God and the testimony of Yeshua. So you've got that same three stages here, although in the case of Esther, that's really cut short by the fact that about the time he realizes Esther's heritage is the same time that Xerxes is just like, all right, that's enough with him.
Oh, yeah.
We'll get to that in due time here. But yeah, it's my turn here. So next stanza, in mine, it reads from 7 to 11. Is that the same as yours, Matthew?
Yeah, that worked.
Okay. In the first month, which is the month Nisan, in the 12th year of King Ahasuerus, Pur, that is the lot, was cast before Haman in the day to day, from day to day and from month to month, until the 12th month, that is the month of Adar. Then Haman said to King Ahasuerus, "There is a certain people scattered and dispersed among the peoples in all the provinces of your kingdom. Their laws are different from all those other people, in that they do not observe the king's laws, so it is not in the king's interest to let them remain. If it is pleasing to the king, let it be decreed that they be destroyed, and I will pay 10,000 talents of silver into the hands of those who carry on the king's business to put into the king's treasuries." Then the king took his signet ring from his hand and gave it to Haman, the son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, the enemy of the Jews. The king said to Haman, "The silver is yours, and the people also, to do with them as you please."
Ah, very good.
Good stuff.
There we have that. Matthew?
Okay.
Well, let me say this. It's time for us to talk a little bit about timelines, because we were just given, well, really, quite a miraculous code there in the Bible. For one, understand this, that Nisan is only mentioned in two verses, and both those verses are a reckoning of time within the king's list. Mm-hmm. I'll read them. The first one is Nehemiah 2:1, and it came about in the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, that wine was before him. And he took up wine and gave it to the king. Now, I had not been sad in his presence. And the other one we just read. But take note that this is a specific calculation, and you can get the time between those two dates is actually 29 years. Now, it's actually 28 years and some months. But that can only take you one place in the Bible. And concerning a woman, well, it's very interesting because let me just read these verses. I'll take 2 Kings 14:2. He was 25 years old when he became king, and he reigned 29 years in Jerusalem. And his mother's name was Jehoaddan of Jerusalem. Now, if I read through each of these verses, the next one's in 2 Kings 18, verse 2, 2 Chronicles 25, verse 1, and 2 Chronicles 29, verse 1. And all four times it says this, and his mother's name was. So this is very strange that here, I mean, everyone is readily able to understand that normally a king was known by their father, not by their mother.
Yeah. Interesting.
So, very much.
Even though we don't have time to delve too deeply into this concerning time, I want everybody to understand what we're really talking about here. most Bible scholars don't take the time out to tell you that this was after the temple was built. It was done. The temple was completed. The second temple period began in 519.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's important that everybody should know right here, that all of these events that are going on in Esther and, you know, Ezra and Nehemiah, that is rebuilding the rest of the city. The temple was already built. But there was something that was to come that I think everybody should know, because most Bible prophecy teachers don't speak about this, but you need to understand something that is really detrimentally important to the coming of the king. Okay? Everybody knows the prophecy about Daniel's 70 weeks, and we can go once around the right on that, but I'm just going to tell you the facts of the matter, because this is true. And when I say this, you're going to understand why what was going on in Jerusalem before the king happened, because when you take 519 and you go 483 years, you run right smack dab into King Herod, because that'll take you to 36 BC. And don't you know that Herod was proclaimed king of the Jews in 37 BC?
A year earlier.
The year before. So now you understand why Herod took on the massive building project, because, well, the temple was not as high as it should be. You see, the order given, the second temple, was not as tall. It was made shorter by the decree of the king at the time, because foreign temples were not allowed to be too high. They could not be higher than a Persian or Babylonian edifice.
Interesting. You'll note that, I don't know, it's not, well, it's not Persian, but, you know, we have the highest tower right now on Earth is in the Arab Emirates, which that's kind of their thing, isn't it?
Bear in mind that this wasn't just a small architectural matter. If you read the books of Zechariah and Haggai, they are built. They're basically addressing those who saw. As a matter of fact, it talks about in Ezra those who saw the little humble temple they were able to rebuild with the resources they had and under the Persian laws. Those who were old enough to remember Solomon's temple wept with despair when they saw this little tiny structure, probably barely bigger than a synagogue. And both Haggai and Zechariah had to come and say, no, look, I understand. Yes, this is humble for now, but this latter temple, the glory of it will be greater than the first, because in this place I will make peace. And, of course, the rabbis struggle with, okay, what does it mean that the glory of the second temple will be greater than the first one? Does it mean that it will last longer? Does it mean that it will be more beautiful when Herod rebuilds it? And it's interesting, there's a this is probably slightly off topic, but I find the subject intriguing. Let me find the quote really fast here. But Isaac Troki, a 16th century rabbi, wrote, "Nor can we admit that the glory of the second temple consisted in its longer duration, a point discussed in the Talmud, for the scripture makes no mention of the glory being attributed to the length of time during which the temple was constructed or lasted. And even if the duration of the second temple had exceeded by double the time that the first temple, the word glory could not have been assigned to this distinction." And he basically goes on, he knocks down this idea that it could be something to do with how long the temple lasted, or, you know, Herod rebuilding or something like that. But that's actually an enormous gap in rabbinic theology, because it's like, okay, how was Haggai's prophecy fulfilled? Well, of course, we who know Messiah in Yeshua, and we know, who know how he gave us peace, and we know, who know that he was indeed the glory of the living God, the very same glory that dwelt over the Ark of the Covenant in the first temple, clothed in human flesh, incarnated and walking among us, can see how the second temple's glory was actually greater than the first, because indeed in that place was given peace. And that actually connects with something we'll get to, verse 15, in just a minute. It's kind of intriguing, but I wanted to throw in something else, and that's when Haman's offering to pay silver for the blood of the Jews, silver throughout Scripture is connected with this whole idea of blood, believe it or not. You've got, for example, when you in Judaism, when we have a firstborn son, we have to redeem him with a price of silver, a half shekel. Okay. When Joseph was with his brothers and he's testing them, he puts a silver cup in Benjamin's sack. Okay, that's actually significant for a number of reasons, but it's actually connected to the cup of Yeshua, which is a cup of what? Well, as this cup, he pulls out the cup of the Passover, he says, "This is my blood of the new covenant." So we have that connection with blood. The foundation, the sockets that the tabernacle walls were set in were made of silver. And the foundation of God's worship was made on blood.
They were cups. They were cups that held timbers.
Yeah, exactly. It is to hold the whole thing upright. So it was,
very heavy. Literally giant cups.
Yeah, exactly. But they were giant cups of silver. They were giant cups of this blood metal. And just to drive the point home, when Judas shows up in the temple with, you know, his 30 pieces of silver, he throws it down saying, "I have betrayed innocent blood." And when he goes away, they're like, "Well, what do we do with this? It's blood money. We can't put it in the treasury." So all through Scripture, we have this weird connection between silver and blood. And that is that, and here we see that Haman wants a blood price, if you will, paid of the Jews, and he's willing to pay the silver for it. It's again that that connection between the silver and the blood there.
Is there a deeper connection between silver and blood that you're driving at?
Not really. It's a symbolic connection, and it's not one I'm able to put down to anything in the element of silver. I mean, colloidal silver is apparently useful in fighting certain types of infection, it's not something that's particularly connected with blood. Silver doesn't look like blood, but nevertheless, there's a symbolic linkage between silver and blood all through the Scriptures.
Silver is good for your blood. That's what I was thinking. It's a very shallow thought, but I'm glad you were thinking it too. You know, people take colloidal silver and it fights infections and all kinds of blood problems.
But, you know, it's interesting, you know, Haman, when King Ahasuerus accepts Haman's proposal, he says, "Look, keep your silver. Do what you want." You know, apparently he liked Haman enough to do this. And it's kind of interesting that there's almost parallel there with, you see in the book of Job, where God, you know, lays limits on what Satan can do, but he says, "All right, fine, I'm putting him in your hand temporarily to test him." All right?
Yeah.
In the same way, the Jewish people, after Yeshua came, were, and indeed before Yeshua came, actually from the time of the Babylonian captivity on, you could make the case that, just like Job, God put us into the hand of the enemy to be tested. And this was actually part of the whole curse that is described in Deuteronomy chapter 28. In great detail, by the way. That's a prophecy that I've been really delving into recently.
Oh, it's a reoccurring theme, the Jews being, you know, put into the enemy's hands to be tested. It's over and over and over again. And it's finally going to come to a grand a repeat of the same theme in the end times.
Yep, exactly. And as a final point here, and then I'll step back for Matthew again, is Nisan is the month of Passover.
April?
And that became April or March. This year, Passover happens to be falling in March. Because the Jewish calendar, it's based on a lunar calendar, so each month is 29 and a half days, so 29 or 30 days alternating generally. And then every 2 to 3 years, it's on this 19-year cycle, I won't try to lay it all out, we insert a 13th month to keep the calendar connected to the harvest times. Now, like the Muslims, for example, have the same lunar calendar, but they don't stick in that 13th month. And so that's why Ramadan drifts backwards every year. You know, a few years ago, it was in December, and now it's in the middle of summer. So, but we, because our feast and our calendar is all tied to the harvest times, we have that intercalculary, a leap month, if you will, to keep the feast and the harvest synchronized. And so, you know, this whole event that we're talking about, where the king gives Haman permission to destroy the Jews, and what we're going to be seeing with Esther approaching the king, all this takes place at the time of Passover.
not to jump completely way to the end or way far ahead, but I have to ask this before I forget. Is there any connection between Purim and Jubilee?
No, not really. Purim's not a high holy day. It is a relatively minor holy day. The seven, well, actually eight holy days or holy times are Sabbath, which of course happens every week, and therefore people forget about it, but it's considered the most important of the holy days in Judaism. So you got Sabbath, Passover, first fruits, unleavened bread. You could argue which order those two go in. Shavuot, which you would know as Pentecost. And then you've got Feast of Trumpets, the Yom Kippur, the feast, fast of the Day of the Atonement, and then Sukkot. And those are your primary. You've got seven yearly feasts and then a weekly feast, which gives you the eighth.
And then you have a feast at the end of every 49 years, which is Jubilee. That's not right. Really a feast, is it?
No, well, that's connected to the Jubilee, but basically the 50th year is basically a big credit reset for everybody. Basically,
right.
The idea was so that no one person could accumulate all the territory in Israel and make everyone their slaves. They have to give it all back every 50 years.
Right.
And no family is completely made destitute forever based on an ancestor's mistakes.
Right. All debts are forgiven and all property returns to the original owner.
And all slaves are set free.
Boy, we could use a year of Jubilee here now in our present world condition, couldn't we?
Yeah, we could. Now, interestingly enough, Rabbi Khan, and I'm trying to remember his first name, and it's escaping me at the moment. Hold on, I've got his book right here. Let me double check this. Rabbi Jonathan Khan, he's a Messianic rabbi, and he wrote a book called The Harbinger. And I think I recommended this before. You can actually see his presentation on YouTube. But what he doesn't give in his YouTube presentation that he explains in his book is that 9/11 occurred on the day, on the 20, basically the last day of the month of Elul, the day right before the Feast of Trumpets in 2001. And then you fast forward, the stock market crash that followed in 2008 happened also at the exact same time of the Jewish calendar, which is incidentally when there is a forced credit reset, the land is supposed to be left fallow, and so forth. So it's like almost like God imposed a sabbatical year twice on America.
Interesting. That is interesting. That is very enlightening. There's a lot to think about there for the next few weeks.
Yeah, I'm copying out some notes and stuff, and I want to take Rabbi Khan's work, and I want to combine it with the work of David Brennan in the Israel Omen 1 and 2, and George McTernan in As America's Done to Israel, because I'm trying to really understand prophetically what's happening in this country and the pattern of – I believe we've seen many, many judgments put on America, including the very bizarre weather we're experiencing right now up in the north. I'm trying to get a better grip on the pattern and how it all fits together. So that will hopefully turn into an article or maybe even a whole book at some point if I can find time to write. But at the very least, I hope to have some articles put up on the website about that in the not too distant future. There's a fascinating set of judgments coming on America, and the fact that they follow Israel so exactly tells me that America doesn't have the same covenant Israel does, but God seems to be holding America accountable in a way that he has not held any nation since Israel.
And I think that's because that America was the only other country besides Israel that was dedicated to God at its inception.
So, precisely right.
Yeah. We are not, for the replacement theologists out there, we are not Israel. But it seems to be that we are held accountable just because of our, that we were dedicated to God at our inception. So now he's like, okay, you want to do that? Now I'm going to hold you accountable.
I actually think America is probably the only, I would say, true Christian nation in the history of the world. New Zealand, maybe. I don't know enough about New Zealand. I know they are officially Christian in their constitution. But America was actually run and set up according to Torah principles of government, including a lot of people don't realize this, but Torah actually says that the people are supposed to select their own leaders. God picks the Levites, and holds and basically runs his country as a king through his priests. But on a day-to-day basis, the villages were supposed to pick their own leaders, their own elders, who would handle their own affairs, and it was supposed to be like this loose confederation that would appeal to Jerusalem when they just ran into a problem that was too big for them to handle on an individual level, and where the individual villages and tribes and such would actually decide when to appeal up the ladder. They wouldn't have it imposed from the top down.
Yes, and God was never at, and he was never in favor of rulership by king either. I mean, he right. was more, you know, it was more like the way America's set up is what God had pretty much intended.
Yeah, exactly. And it's actually interesting. In America, it's actually part of our uniform flag code that the American flag bows before no earthly king. So there are some interesting connections there, and I'm actually delving in deep right now, trying to understand better my own country's spiritual heritage, because, of course, you know, were the Freemasons involved in the foundation of the country?
Sure.
Yes. But that doesn't, you know, like sure. George Washington, for example, by his own writings, he was a very dedicated Christian, Freemason or not.
Yeah.
And so I think we have to be careful about being too simplistic and say, oh, well, since Freemasons were involved, it's Luciferian. Well, not really. The stuff we know about Freemasons being Luciferian came from the 18th century. Or correction, the 19th century.
Oh, that's
from like 100 years later.
Their original form may have well been very, very God-oriented.
I think the original form was very humanist-oriented. Based on my readings, the Freemasons as an organization did not actually exist before 1717, as we now know them. Before that, they were like an architectural firm.
Right, a guild.
After that, they became – yeah, exactly. What happened was Britain basically shut down a whole bunch of Catholic building projects that the Masons had their money invested in. They were in deep trouble financially, and so they – and I've read that there was a Protestant minister involved or something like that. I don't remember the exact details or names off the top of my head. But basically they said, you know what? Let's open up our doors and charge people fees. And at that point, you know, when the Freemasons started, they had three levels. They had apprentice, journeyman, and master. They proceeded to add on another 30 levels because that way they could keep charging people to go up the ladder.
Yeah.
And it became this big discussion group that started talking about, okay, you know, this divine right of kings thing. What if that kings don't have a divine right? The church running the state and vice versa. What if that's not the way? And the ideas that at the time would have gotten people killed, but because Freemasons wouldn't turn in a non-Mason, they could discuss in the lodges. That's why so many of the founding fathers were Masons. That was the only place they could discuss these ideas and not get hung. Okay. The stuff where, Albert Pike and what's the other guy's name?
Oh, yeah.
Manly P. Hall.
Yeah, Manly P. Writing. Hall.
That yeah,
the secret teaching of all ages.
Exactly. That was 100 years after Washington. And I don't buy that the Freemasons have actually managed to stay static and pass down things for thousands of years. I really don't. I think that, like any other organization, they evolved. And once the idea of human rights and human dignity was no longer radical, people came in with other radical ideas.
Sure,
and
yeah.
I, just based on everything I've read, all of his own writings, his diaries, and everything else, George Washington would never have joined an openly Luciferian organization, nor would he have stayed in there for 5 minutes if he thought it was Luciferian.
Right. I think a lot of the conspiratorial stuff has been, just like you said, really based on things that were after the Founding Fathers by 100 years.
Right.
But during the period of the Founding Fathers, they were more interested in creating a God-centered and God-based nation based
one
on
where
principles
no
of
fallible human being, no one single fallible human being could wield the power that they thought only God should wield.
We are endowed by our Creator with certain unalienable rights. I mean, it's all
exactly.
founded on that idea that we are free men that have been given rights by God, not men, not kings.
Precisely right. And the thing is, you know, do I believe that America is Babylon? Well, I think America is a daughter of Babylon. I think Mystery Babylon in Revelation 17 is clearly Rome. You know, you ask anyone in the first century who the city that sits on seven hills that rules over the kings of the earth is, they're like, Rome, duh. But we also know that she's a mother of harlots and that she has daughter harlots. And I do believe America is a daughter harlot. But you only get the title of harlot in Scripture if you once knew God and then turned away from him. Nineveh was not called a harlot until after they repented at the preaching of Jonah.
Yes.
And so if America's a harlot, it means that we once truly walked with God.
Yes. Yes, you would have to have something to turn away from. I really fall in line with Peter Goodgame's new idea about Mystery Babylon, at least, and that is not any one nation or king, but actually the whole world system, which is definitely anti-Christ.
I would partially agree with that. Babylon is, you know, just like you've got these, you know, it's powers, these archangels, these gods, or whatever you want to call them, that rule over nations. Mystery Babylon seems to be a spirit that moved from place to place. It started in Nineveh. And then when the Ninevites were overthrown by the Babylonians, moved back to Babylon, where it probably originated in the days of Nimrod, and appears to have gone to Tyre at one point. Because if you read the judgment against Tyre, it reads like a paraphrase of the judgment against Babylon and Nineveh. And so you've got this entity that keeps following the money, keeps following the power.
Right.
And therefore keeps corrupting its religion in the name of following the money and following the power.
Some would tell you that's all based on the sin of usury.
Yeah. There's some truth to that. And, you know, that's why Revelation describes these 24 these 24 exports that go through Mystery Babylon, and it ends with the bodies and souls of men, because usury ultimately becomes a means of putting people in slavery.
Right. That's what I was saying.
And getting back to what we said earlier, that's why God had a credit reset and why God said you can't keep a indentured servant more than 6 years, because it was to spare Israel the horror of having perpetual slaves. And the you know, soul draining, mind numbing conditions that entails in any society. But you know, as far as America goes, I'm actually leaning towards us being the seventh head of the beast.
Because
you've got these, we know the sixth head is Rome. You can count backwards from there, and then all we know about the seventh head is that it's sometime future to John. It would remain for only a short time. And it's like, okay, what do all the heads have in common? Well, they're all around when Israel's around, so it can't be anyone between 70 CE and 1948.
You know,
who's the power that rules over the Middle East and who is dominant over Israel now that Israel's back in land? It's us.
You know, I would I'd argue with you on that. I really think these are actual kings rather than nations or kingdoms.
Well, they could be. I mean, you could say kingdoms. You could also say that.
Have you ever?
Okay, it's the Pharaoh of the Exodus, Sennacherib of Assyria,
yes,
Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, or alternately his son who decided to play with God's cups and use them for a drinking game.
Yes,
Haman of Persia, who, although he wasn't king, he wielded the power of the king for a brief time.
Antiochus Epiphanes, who set up the original abomination of desolation.
Precisely, and then either Nero or Domitian.
Domitian,
or
probably.
Domitian, because that would be the one who was actually around when John wrote the Revelation.
Right, and the seventh being Hitler continued on for a short time with only one.
That's possible.
Yes.
But remember, Israel wasn't in the land when Hitler was in power.
He was given
all
a great sword. I mean,
all the other kings have to do with Israel going into or out of the land. So maybe... But you got to be careful on that one.
Yeah, you know, I haven't gotten very deep into that. I know he was only continued for a short time, and he was given a sword to go out and conquer. That was his whole purpose. Mm-hmm. It was his whole reason for being, and he had a very short span there and did a whole lot of world damage in one short time.
Well, I actually think Hitler is sort of prophesied in Revelation chapter 12, because you've got this war in heaven. And it's got to be a truly epic war if it's the one where the adversary is finally cast down by Michael and his angels. Well, wars in heaven are reflected on wars on earth, so you'd expect to see some kind of massive war that coincides with it. And what happens when the dragon falls down? He starts off by persecuting the woman, trying to destroy her.
Oh, yeah.
The result of this is that she flees into a place that is called a wilderness, a desert, or a desolation is actually what the word means. But it's also called her place. Well, if the woman is the Jewish people, where is her place that was a desert when she first came to it? Well, that would be the land. And then the dragon sends out a flood after her, which in like Psalm 29, I think, for example, and Daniel chapter 9 represents a flood of an army. But the land opens up its mouth and swallows it. And if you do some reading or some watching on what happened in 1948 that kept the Jews in Israel from being completely wiped out by six Arab nations fully equipped coming against this tiny, ill-equipped, you know, not even, you know, in any way, shape, or form prepared land, and how they got defeated, the land opened up its mouth and swallowed them. And then it says that the dragon, you know, when he realized he couldn't destroy the woman there, went on and waged war against the rest of her children, who keep the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus or Yeshua. Well, after 1948, when Israel went back land, Christian persecution around the world, and especially in the Middle East, spiked up big time.
Oh, yeah.
So I actually think that Revelation 12 is in our past. As strange as that sounds to people, I think 13 is what we're getting ready to watch come out as the beast comes out of the sea. But the I think that Revelation chapter 12 has already happened. Well, if so, the adversary fell to earth, and here's the part that connects to you. You remember how Pergamos is described as having Satan's throne?
Yes.
Archaeologists actually identify that as this temple of Zeus that actually was shaped in a horseshoe shape like a throne. You know where there was a place called the Pergamos Museum,
Germany.
Where they built a replica of that, Berlin.
Yes.
Yes. They built Satan's throne in Berlin.
I know.
Just before Hitler came to power.
I know. That's
Gee,
why
I wonder who was down on the earth who needed a throne again.
He's the seventh king. Let's I need to pound on Matthew Miller's chest, and but I'm gonna leave
I'm
it
sorry,
to you.
Dominate the subject.
I'm gonna pound on Matthew Miller's chest, but Rabbi Mike, I'm going to leave it to you to give Matthew mouth to mouth and get him breathing again.
Okay. Let me say this. We do have more inferences of time here. We have in John chapter 2, verse 20, and the king did not counter this statement. We built or were building this temple for 46 years. Mm-hmm. I want everybody to consider everything that Rabbi Mike and Johnny was just talking about, okay? Because what I told you before, okay, understand this, that historically speaking, we know this beyond any shadow of a doubt, that Herod was able to miraculously hire 1,000 priests as masons and carpenters. Okay, that's not natural. They were already in preparation to do this, and Herod came along as a miraculous intervention, because at the time the priest had no idea just exactly how they were going to do it. Now, on top of this, I want you to consider this. That makes it 29 AD. And when you roll back, or roll forward, 490 years, on the fifth pass, you're going to come to 1930. Let me tell you some things about 1930. For one.
Whoa.
For one, Eretz Israel, which is what the Jewish people call for the migration home, that year it reached 175,000. But this is what's even more important. At the year before that, 1929, the Nazi Party was only at about 170,000. By the end of 1930, it had 4 million. And I'm not done. Because in 1930, the Nazi Party won 107 seats in the Reichstag. Okay? And I'm not done. I'm not done. Because if you're a Jew, and I say 1930, they'll say the Shaw Report. Because of the massacre that happened at the Tomb of the Patriarchs in Hebron.
Mm-hmm.
This report was issued and founded in 1930. That's when it was given. And what is the most important thing about the Shaw Report is this, and I'm just going to read this to you right off the bat. It found that the purchases of lands by Jewish companies had been legal and fair to the tenants. Now think about what I just said. On top of everything that Johnny and Rabbi Mike just said, I said, when you take that date, the Jews were obviously preparing for the Messiah, okay? Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, here comes Herod the Great, and Rome crowns him kings of the Jews. He shows up to the Sanhedrin, says, hey, I'll finance all your rebuilding projects. Now, that's how the historical references, when it says that he hired 1,000 masons and carpenters, and they were miraculously priests, because only priests could do the work. Well, that's how. That's why. And when you take 490 years and throw it once, throw it twice, three times, four times, the fifth time, you land in 1930. So everything that Johnny and Rabbi Mike just discussed, you might want to think about it a little bit more.
Wow, you've brought the math to this. Wow.
Oh, man, I need to, for one of our future things, I've got to dig out an old chart I drew up in part from something that Chuck Missler mentioned, but points out that you can actually, based on a prophecy in Ezekiel, calculate both the when Israel would be resurrected in 1948 and when Jerusalem would be recaptured in 1967. I'll have to dig that out because I'm. If I try to do it now off the top of my head, I know I'll get a whole bunch of stuff wrong on it. But yeah, I mean, the fact is God has all these wonderful patterns and so forth that are there for the express purpose, not so that we can guess in advance, but so that we look back and we go, ah, now we see God's hand. Just like in our lives, you know, there are a lot of times when we don't know why we're going through this, that, and the other thing. But then we look back, you know, 5, 10 years down the road, and we're like, now I see exactly how God was shaping me for what I'm doing right now.
490 isn't. I know. I mean, I'm thinking about the 49 years leading up to Jubilee. That seems to be a reoccurring number for God. 49 and 490.
Well, it should be based on Daniel's prophecy, the 70 weeks, because
right,
the 70
right.
weeks. Weeks of years is 490 years.
Right. Okay, there it is. That's what I was thinking subconsciously. Okay.
Yeah. One of the things you have to remember with Daniel's prophecy is, okay, Israel was given a sentence of 70 years because for 490 years we had not kept the sabbatical year, the Shemitah. And the issue there, God was less concerned about the agriculture than the fact that debts weren't being released, servants weren't being allowed to go free. And as a matter of fact, there's an incident in the book of Jeremiah, I'd have to look up chapter and verse on it, where, Israel repented and said, okay, we're going to let our slaves go. And then, you know, not long after this, like, you know, I really miss having slaves. Let's go get them back. And basically took all these slaves and took them back. God's like, all right, you have not kept my commandment for 490 years. You owe me 70. So all of you who took your slaves back, you're going to know what it is like to be slaves. And therefore, we had the 70-year captivity in Babylon. Daniel, as he's coming up on the end of the 70-year captivity, he's praying because he's like, no, we have not repented. We are not worthy of what has been promised to us, but please fulfill it anyway. And then God comes up with this 490-year. Why is that significant? Because in Leviticus 26, I believe, God makes this point of saying, hey, when I punish you, if you will not repent, I will extend your punishment 7 times more.
Oh, yes.
So that's 70 years of punishment. Then there's a space of time given for Israel to get its act together between the release under Ezra in the book of Ezra and when Nehemiah is sent out. Israel still doesn't fully repent, and therefore there's a 490-year further extension where we have to wait for Messiah. And then we get to year 483, still don't repent. So there's another extension, which has gone on for about the last 2,000 years now.
Then we get to 1930, and God really lets the bomb drop on him.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man.
And we literally – well, what we did, Johnny – well, what we did literally, Johnny, was start the sixth day in 1930.
Mm-hmm.
The sixth day?
There is an idea. If you go through and you add up all the genealogies in Scripture, of course, Bishop Unger is famous for this, but you end up with, assuming no gaps, about 6,000 years of history. You've got 4,000 basically from Adam to Yeshua, and then, of course, the last 2,000 added to that. Since God speaks and has this cosmic millennium, it's as if this the 1,000-year millennium is the cosmic Sabbath for the previous 6,000 years. And by the way, that's an idea the rabbis came to independent of Revelation. That's actually one reason premillennialism, what we would call premillennialism today, was rejected by the early church fathers who went for amillennialism. They didn't like how Jewish the idea was.
Interesting. You know, most of us, for those who don't know about those terms, most of us are premillennialists. You know, a lot of us, you know, eschatology guys, end times, you know, guys, we pretty much hold that we're in the time before the millennial reign of Christ right now.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Exactly.
But they dismissed that, you're saying, out of hand because it seemed too Jewish.
Oh, the church dismissed a lot of stuff out of hand because they decided it was too Jewish. I mean, they dismissed having Jewish members. They required that if someone was born Jewish and they wanted to become a good Christian and thus be saved, they had to repudiate their Jewishness, not just, you know, give up certain Jewish practices or anything like that, but they had to give up everything that made them Jewish, and even to the point where I think in the 8th century in Constantinople, a very vile oath was forced upon Jews where they agreed never to have anything to do with the Jews again, except maybe to argue with them. It was, and I believe that part of the reason, that the major reason why the allegedly Christian Roman Empire fell first to the Germanic tribes in the West and then to Islam in the East was because this supposedly Christian organization took basically spread a gospel of gentilization. You know, we've heard of the gospel of Judaizing, the false gospel that Paul talks about,
right?
Which is telling Gentiles, hey, you must become a Jew in order
right.
to be saved. It's not enough to believe in Yeshua the Messiah, Jesus the Christ. You must also become a Jew. Well, the church turned that around and said, well, you know, said to the Jews, it's not enough for you to believe that Yeshua or Jesus is the Messiah. You must also stop being a Jew. It's the same sin. It comes under the same penalty. It's just flipped on its head.
It's like a lashback.
Exactly. It's just as much a false gospel. So it should not surprise us that the Roman Empire collapsed pretty much the instant Christianity took control of it. It's very fascinating to see that. But you know, the West fell to Germanic tribes that were half Aryan, half pagan. And actually, what's his name? Dan Carlin does the Hardcore History podcast, and one of his more recent podcasts actually deals with that whole issue, and it's really good to listen to. But the West fell to a combination of Arianism, which is pretty close to, you know, the Jehovah's Witnesses, and paganism, and then the East got eaten up bit by bit by Islam. Now, through all this, Christianity endured. But the sad thing is, Christians were just like, oh, we're just suffering with Christ, instead of going, huh, you know, if God's passing judgment on this many of us and we're facing, you know, Rome collapsing and being sacked by these barbarians and the Eastern Empire being taken apart by the, you know, heathen Muslims and all that, what did we do wrong?
Well, we didn't listen to Jesus when he gave his advice, rend unto Caesar what is Caesar's and unto God what is God's.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he meant by that. Don't make a theocracy out of Christianity.
Well, I mean, you know, if rulers become Christian, you expect that to filter down. But you know, what form of Christianity?
Right. Okay. I mean, yeah.
And Christianity became very paganized, and you notice that the Great Commission went nowhere for 1,000 years from the time that the West fell. And Islam rose up to the time of the Reformation. Christianity did nothing in terms of spreading beyond Europe. Why did God pin it down there so long if the Great Commission is the church's whole reason for being? Well, perhaps the church needs to carefully re-examine and say, okay, what exactly were the sins? And let's not fool ourselves by pointing fingers at everyone else. Let's actually look at where did we go wrong. And I'm convinced a large part of that was that the church refused to look at the Jews as, okay, we, you know, regardless of the fights between the Jewish authorities and the apostles, we recognize they were all Jews, and we owe the Jews for the fact that we even know God, and therefore we will love the Jews, even if they don't love us. and, you know, we will follow Messiah and loving those we don't really see as lovable, but instead said, no, we're going to, you know, make those Christ killers suffer. And as a result, there was no true gospel given to the Jews for the better part of 1,700 years. Okay. God was going to let that stand. Furthermore, you know, as soon as the pagans showed up, Christianity started accommodating and adopting pagan customs and even adopting pagan gods as saints. Anyone who's ever heard of Saint Bacchus knows that to be true.
That's bad.
Exactly. But it's kind of fascinating because it's like Christianity went through the exact same problems that Israel went through.
You know, you look at
the history of Christianity, it's like reading the books of 1 and 2 Kings all over again.
Oh, now I get the picture. Okay. Yeah, I was lost for a minute. Thank you for capping that. Now I get it. But Matthew, the sixth day, why was 1930 the sixth, the beginning of the sixth day, and how long will that last?
Well, a day, so to speak, as in the Hebrew, would be like a yom, a period of time. It's just 490, what was dictated by the angel Gabriel to the Lord's servant Daniel. We just take that and just kept wrapping it around, but we understand looking back why John chapter 2, verse 20 says that, because the Jews were preparing for Messiah to come, and in order to do that, they had already started construction on the Temple Mount. They, well, Johnny, look at it this way. They hired Stanley Steemer to come do the carpets. they hired the window guys to come do the windows. They were actually preparing for the Messiah. This is why, of course, when the king did come, well, Anna was there waiting on him, was she not? And, well, everything that happened, now you understand why they were there at the Temple Mount waiting. Because in their eyes, the Romans declaring Herod king of the Jews in that magical year right before 36 A.D., and he stepped right on in and he said, hey, boys, I'll fund your project. They knew all this was going on. And, well, looking back, it can be, well, very prophetic if you know what to look for. But you have to be, you know, you have to be reading the Bible. You know, you have to be worried about biblical things and God's timeline and those types of things. And we're going to get into time here in the next verses, that's for sure. Actually, ladies and gentlemen, this next stanza, I'm not going
to... Real quick, but Matthew, before you go on to that, I'm just curious.
Yes, sir.
Herod, of course, was an Edomite. The Roman word would be Edomian, but the Edomites got pushed over into southern Judea by the Nabataeans. And there's actually some good reason to believe that the modern descendants of Esau would be the Palestinians. Do you see any significance at all to, you know, the fact that Herod, an Edomite, built the temple? And I've just been sort of pondering whether that might, you know, well, okay, what how would that tie into sort of the pattern reoccurring today? I'm just curious on your thoughts on that.
Well, once again, I really didn't want to go here, but now that you're going to, I guess I will. Ladies and gentlemen, I mentioned to you earlier the 29 years, and it's tied to the king in some strange reason. It gives the mother's name. The only other time that word, those numbers, are used in the scripture is in Genesis 11:24. And we can take those two names, and I'm sure Rabbi Mike can just go to town on what I'm going to read. Because this is before. Okay, this is before. And this is why the rabbis realized in their minds what was happening. But let me read it for you. Genesis 11:24. Nahor lived 29 years, and he became the father of Terah. Now, me and Rabbi Mike could probably go on and on, because, see, this is before the Lord stepped in, because the next little bit of genealogy, God steps into the timeline. And if you just take the two names here, I mean, I could spend 2 hours on just the two names. But this ties back into exactly what Rabbi Mike was bringing up about the Edomites. And, I mean, we could tie in the prophecies that say that in the latter days there will be a slaughter in Bozra, even in Petra. And, well, that's right where those people were from. That is Edom.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately, we really don't have time to go there.
Okay, do you want to just table that one and we'll kick it around another time, just make a note out of it? Because I know I derailed that there.
Yeah.
It's one of those things that it's like, okay, I wanted to get your opinion on it, but it sounds like you're like me. You have to set it up right because you don't want it to be you don't want to give like a pat answer that people misunderstood. So if you want to table that and finish this and we'll come back to it another day, that would be great.
All right, that's fine.
I mean, don't just, if you want to go, just go. But I put you on the spot there.
No, it's just that the next verses, I've got so much to cover, and
okay.
We're down to 25 minutes here, and believe me, I'll have 25 minutes just to talk about these next verses.
All right. In that case, let's table that one. I'll step out of your way and go to town on verses 12 through 15 there.
All right. I shall read them. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the last stanza in Esther chapter 3. And you might want to put your thinking caps on. Once again, God does some rather miraculous things here with the Hebrew language. We just can't get it in English. We just can't. But anyway, verse 12. Then the king's scribes were summoned on the 13th day of the first month, and it was written, just as Haman commanded, to the king's satraps, to the governors who were over each province, and to the princes of each people, each province according to its script, each people according to its language, being written in the name of King Ahasuerus and sealed with the king's signet ring. Letters were sent by couriers to all the king's provinces to destroy and kill and to annihilate all the Jews, both young and old, women and children, in one day. On the 13th day of the 12th month, which is month of Adar, and to seize their possessions as plunder. A copy of the edict to be issued as law in every province was published to all the people so that they should be ready for this day. The couriers went out impelled by the king's command while the decree was issued at the citadel in Susa. And while the king and Haman sat down to drink, the city of Susa was in confusion. Rabbi Mike, take her away.
Okay. First thing we really need to note in verse 12, the date, the 13th day of the first month. Now, it specifies that the first month in verse 7 is the month of Nisan. The 13th day is the day before Passover that they actually summoned the king's scribes and wrote out the Haman's orders and began to distribute it. And it's going to be very key when we get to chapter 4. I want to just sort of leave that hanging there for a moment. It is to take place on the 13th day of the 12th month. So all this is to take place exactly 11 months later. Now, 11 is a really interesting number when it comes to Scripture, and it's one that, strange enough, the occultists and Luciferians seem to have picked up on. If you've got, for example, the beast, and he is the little horn that comes up among the 10 horns. So he's the 11th horn, for example. There were 11 curtains that separated the children of Israel from the glory of God in the tabernacle. So, and here we have the 11 months that are the countdown for the destruction of the Jews. So over and over again, 11 is an ill-omened number, if you will. It's a number that's associated with sin. You know, you've got the 11 kings, the beast and his 10, who set out to make war against the Lamb. You've got 11 curtains that separate us from God, just like our sin separates us from God. You've got the 11 months of destruction here. Now, the thing that really, that's sort of the setup for chapter 4 here, but the thing that I find really fascinating here, remember that would have been the first, as a matter of fact, it was verse 2. We mentioned that the word for the citadel in Susa, or Shushan, is actually how it's pronounced in Hebrew. The word for the citadel is Habirah. And it is used only of Shushan here in Esther and also in, I believe, the book of Daniel, chapter 8, verse 2. And it is also used of the temple of God in 1 Chronicles 29:1 and also 29, verse 19. So, you know, just the principle we've been going at this whole way through here, when you've got a word that only appears in a handful of places, all those places are linked. So this, when it talks about the king's decree is issued at the citadel, that's as if, that's symbolically, you know, when we're looking at this prophetically, that's like saying that the king's decree is issued at the temple. And indeed, if we look at, for example, at the fall of the first temple in the book of Ezekiel, it is in Ezekiel's vision, he's carried back to the temple, and that is where he hears God's decree against Israel. That's where he hears the glory of the Lord saying, "Let us depart from here," and he actually sees it departing from the temple, pausing at several points to see if the people repent before finally departing. That's where he sees the reason for the Lord's decree against Israel. He sees that the priests were carrying out idolatry in the hidden places of the temple. That's where he sees the angelic scribe come out to put a mark on the heads of those who were true to God to protect them through the coming catastrophe. So it is in, just like in Ezekiel's vision, the decree of God was made in the temple. Here we have it made in a symbolic temple in the Habirah. Just like Yeshua's decree against Jerusalem in Matthew 23 was issued in the temple and as he departed the temple, just like the glory of the Lord in Ezekiel. So this all ties in prophetically at this particular point with the departure of the Holy One, which, by the way, Yeshua's final departure from the temple right before his Last Supper would have been on the 13th of Nisan. So it's all tying together and creating this prophetic picture of God allowing his people for a time to fall into the hands of their enemies out of his judgment. But as we're going to see in the rest of this book, it is not for their ultimate destruction. It is actually to create a renaissance, if you will, to create a calling back of the people to God.
Amen to that. Speaking of those days, everybody, you'll take note there that the stanza before it made sure that you knew it was talking about the month of Nisan. Well, all of a sudden, it just says the first day of the month here in this stanza. It just says, mm-hmm. You know, the first month. Well, that makes me look at it deeper. And when you do, just take note of this. That word three there, it's only spelled that way in reference to what everybody knows about the, well, the mighty men. It's only spelled that way in 1 Chronicles chapter 11. It's in verse 12. It's in verse 20. It's in verse 24. And it's only spelled that way there, and every time it's with the mighties, as it's called in the King James Version, the mighty 30 men of Israel that was commanded by Abishai, King David's relation and the brother of Joab, the commander of the armies. So, when you catch
For clarification, Matt, because I'm not sure everyone would have caught that, which number three, where are you talking about the number three? Are you talking about in the word 13?
Right.
I just want to make sure, because I just want to make sure everyone else was following her and that I wasn't thinking the wrong thing. Go ahead. I just wanted to make sure that we were all on the same page here.
Yes, in reference to that 13 right there. It can only take you to the mighty men. And mm-hmm. when you see that spelling, just take note of this, that if this was the first of the religious month, encoded here, this would have been the magical days between Yom Kippur and Sukkot. And during those days, there's a particular scripture read. It is exclusive to this time. All Jews read this. It is Deuteronomy chapter 32. It is the song of Moses and the mm-hmm. deliverance song. So it's
it's amazing right there that they don't really mention the month. They don't come out and say it like everybody realizes that the stanza right before it. They made perfectly clear that they wanted you to see that it was the month of Nisan. And it's amazing that God did this thing. Now, next I want to talk about that word there, ring, because this will really get your attention, ladies and gentlemen. That word there for ring, outside of the book of Esther, it's only spelled that way in some very strange places. Now, you're going to take note that it's really only in relationship to the rings associated with the temple or the tabernacle.
The rings for the curtains? The rings for the curtains?
That's right. It's only spelled that way in Exodus 25, Exodus 27, and Exodus 38. It's only spelled that way there. And I'll read those verses to everybody so you get a feel of what I'm talking about. I will read it out of the King James. Just take note that right here when it says rings, it's only spelled that way there in the book of Esther. And thou shalt put the staves into the rings by the sides of the ark, that the ark may be born with them. And Exodus 38:7, and he put the staves into the rings on the sides of the altar to bear it withal. He made the altar hollow with boards. And Exodus 27, sorry, I'm getting these out of order, but in my notes they're kind of scattered. And the staves shall be put into the rings, and the staves shall be put upon the sides of the altar to bear it. And the last time, 25:15, the staves shall be in the rings of the ark. They shall not be taken from it. So when you're a, well, let's say you're a Jew and you're an aspiring rabbi and something like this happens, you understand that every time it's spelled that way was only concerning the staves about how the ark was to be bore.
Mm-hmm.
So this is quite a miraculous thing that though at this point in time, all hope is lost. At this point in time, it said, now look, the Lord was sure that you got the point. Every man, woman, and child was to be killed. All of them.
Because the ring was removed from the king, right? And it wasn't supposed to be removed from the ark. So it shouldn't have been removed from the king's finger. Am I going too shallow on this one?
Oh, I don't think you could be too shallow nor too deep, because really right here we could make a whole lesson just out of this stanza. I mean, I'm not even close to being done. But just understand that right here in the text, I mean, this is the worst chapter of them all. This is when the fate has been sealed of the Jews. At this point in time, this command cannot be rescinded.
No, once the ring is removed from the king's finger, it's done.
That's right. That's right. They're doomed. Really? Really? Well, take note. It's the staves that go through that ring. And make no mistakes about it, that ark will never touch the ground. It'll never touch the ground. It will never fall to the earth. Not ever. It's kind of like the Lord's servant Samuel, the miraculous thing that God himself said about Samuel, that not one word of his ever fell to the ground.
No, the word of God does not return void.
Amen. Amen. Mm-hmm. And the next textual anomaly is really intriguing to me, and we could spend a whole lot of time on it, but I want everybody to know that there it says, well, it says some things that's really strange about princes, because there in Hebrew That's spelled the same exact way that some very strange times it's spelled that way. But that's actually, if we translate it into our tongue, it's Sherry. But it's what everybody knows in the Bible as Sarah's name before the Lord changed it. Now, on top of that, it's spelled that way some really strange places. One place is in reference to, well, in reference to the diminished shields. Everybody remembers Solomon's shields, I would imagine. Well, in the text, there when Rehoboam replaces them with brass, right there, and he gives them to the chiefs of the guard, that's how that word is spelled there. It's very intriguing. And there's another place that is one of my favorite places. It mentions Benjamin, only it mentions in reference to that as little. Very prophetic verse. Psalm 68, verse 27. There is little Benjamin with their ruler, the princes of Judah and their council, the princes of Zebulun and the princes of Naphtali. Right there, princes, three times in a row. It's spelled, well, when you look at it in the Hebrew, it can either be Sarah's name before God changed it, or in the same spelling, it's only there in Esther concerning these princes. So, once again, reading that, if it's the first time you've ever read the Bible, and you're a Jew, and it's the first time you've ever been through the Hebrew text, you can plainly see that, oh, this game ain't over. Mm-hmm. This game ain't over. It's not over. Yes, the king had made this decree, and the decree could not be rescinded. But God has a way of working things out. Because at the end of the day, really didn't matter what the king said. Because the Lord, he is God. And besides him, there is no other. And we all should remember that.
But there comes a point when the ring is removed and man is doomed without, or you know, anybody is doomed without God's intervention.
That's right.
Exactly.
That's exactly right, Johnny. That is exactly right.
And that the Israel is almost like a microcosm of the rest of the world. The purpose of Israel being the chosen people was to give a people where God's relationship and God's judgments would be seen by the whole world, so that everyone would understand there is a God who judges, and he judges even those close to him. Therefore, how much more should I repent myself, because I have to face him one day, one way or the other.
That's right. Amen.
Oh yeah, and we will face him. We can count on that. For better or for worse, we will face God. All of us, even the heathen, especially the heathen. And that won't be any fun for them. That's not funny. I shouldn't laugh. I just kind of the way I said it struck me funny. But that's no laughing matter. Go ahead, Matt.
Matthew. Let me throw this on top of that. You'll take note that this word here, pray, it's used, well, it's in Proverbs, it's in Genesis, and it's in Esther. But more importantly, understand that the way this is spelled, the Strong's Concordance has the strange habit of confusing you. Because this spelling is given for two words. One is H962, the other is H937. Okay, so just take note of that. Now, let me read to you the verses in question here, and really is kind of miraculous, actually. But anyway, it comes out of my favorite chapter of the Bible, of course, Genesis 38. And Judah said, "Let her take it to her, lest we be shamed. Behold, I sent this kid, and thou hast not found her." just take note that we are talking about the Book of Esther here, and Judah saying this in the context. Now here, it's not spoiled. It's actually kid. It's goat. I probably got your attention. Let's move on to the next time it's spelled this way, the only other time. It's in Proverbs 12, verse 8. And think about the context that I'm talking about. Because the Lord, your God, obviously chose to spell it this way in this verse for a reason. A man shall be condemned according to his wisdom, but he that is of a perverse heart shall be despised. Let me read that one more time. A man shall be commended according to his wisdom, but he that is of a perverse heart shall be despised. And this thing is certainly true, that Haman did not act wisely. And one thing's for sure, Mordecai must have knew this because he was not going to pay him homage.
And only, what kind of heart does God not despise, Matthew?
An upright heart. He who makes the right decision.
And a broken and contrite heart.
Amen.
That's what I was thinking. The Lord does not despise a broken and contrite heart.
Amen. Which is exactly the opposite of what Mordecai had that day.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Yeah. It's very...
Well, Johnny, here we are. We got 4 minutes left.
So, do you have a broken and contrite heart out there? Contrite's kind of an older, archaic term. It just means you've come to the end of yourself and you are humble before. You're just humbled. You're down in the dirt. You're broke. God does not despise a broken heart. God does not despise somebody who cries out for mercy. Am I lying to you, Rabbi Mike?
You're not lying. There is a reason. As Yeshua said, I've come not to call the well. I've come to heal the sick. The reason why he spent all of his time with sinners was not that he hated the Pharisees. On the contrary, you notice he spent a lot of time with the Pharisees too. A lot of people misunderstand that relationship to be completely hostile, but that wasn't really his point. He's like, look, you don't understand. You have, in trying to walk with God righteously, you've completely distanced yourself from the people that need the most help. I'm here for them. I'm here for the tax collectors that you call traitors to Judah. I am here for the prostitutes that you don't even want to look in the direction at. I'm here even for the Gentiles, the centurions who come and ask me to heal their servants. I'm here for those who need me. I'm here for those who seek me, not for those who are already, you know, pretty nice and self-satisfied. So if you're, you know, listening to this tonight and you're broken, okay, you know you've messed up your life. You know that, you know, you know that things are so bad, and you know, even if on a physical level things look terrible, you know, maybe you could be facing jail. I did prison ministry for a lot of years. Maybe you've messed up so bad that you're facing jail or something like that. You know what? God still loves you. He is still a redeemer. He still sent his son to die for you. Yeshua is still seeking you. He is out looking for the lost. He has left the 99 good sheep to seek out the one lost sheep. He has left the 99 coins that are in the hand to seek out the one that went missing. And when he finds you, there is rejoicing and partying in heaven. Don't make his job finding you to be any more difficult than it needs to be. Just like the father with the prodigal son, when he sees you turning back, he doesn't wait for you to come back. He doesn't make you grow. He races to you and puts a robe on your shoulders and kills the fatted calf to throw a party in your honor that you've come home.
I like the point that you've made is don't make it too difficult. Don't take too long, because I remember the image flashed in my mind of one of my all-time heroes, and it's Father Malachi Martin, the greatest exorcist that ever lived. And he said in the first Art Bell interview, he was 76 and he didn't live to see, he never lived to see 80. And so he died, let's see, that was in 96. He died about 3 years later in 99. And I remember him telling Art, you know, there's always a chance to repent. You know, even the man who was living in sin and pursued by his enemies and jumped off the bridge, you know, did he repent before he hit the water? It's a old, you know, it's an old thing. You just don't know. That's mm-hmm. why you can't judge a person whether they're saved or not. But don't wait that long, because I remember Father Martin said, you know, I wouldn't want to be that man that changed my mind before he hit the water, because, you know, I'm 76 now. And, you know, when you get to be, he goes, one day soon, I'm going to take the high jump. And Art Bell says, as we all shall. And Father Martin says, yes, as we all shall. And he goes, and you know, if you're wise, whatever good you can do, you do before you die. So, the sooner the better, the sooner you can turn and, do that good work. And I'm talking about, Jesus said, you know, he said, I was hungry and you didn't feed me. I was naked and you didn't clothe me. I was sick and I was in prison and you didn't visit me. And they said, when did we ever do these things to you, Jesus? And he said, whenever you've done this to the least of my brethren, you've done that unto me. So that's the kind of works he's talking about, you know. It's time to turn wherever you are. Now is the time to turn and do those good works, you know. Work for the king now. Let's dedicate the rest of our lives in service to the king. And you will be rewarded. Am I lying to you, Matthew Miller?
Negative. That's the truest thing I've ever heard.
Amen. Now, what do I need if I'm listening to this and I'm like, this is cool. This is trippy stuff, man. But, you know, I'm not a Christian, but I really dig all this really trippy, deep thought. What if I decide that, you know what, it's time for me to just go ahead and take God at his word and just go ahead and believe on this? I want like to be a Christian. How might I be saved?
Don't cost you a dime. Bow your head. Repent of your sins. Accept the Son of the living God into your life. And he will engraft you into his family, and you will become an heir. And it's lickety-split that easy.
That didn't hurt a bit.
It's that easy.
Now, it will cost you everything in the end, but that's okay.
Yes, because you're changed from the inside out, not from the outside in, basically.
Exactly right. That's the whole point. You know, some of the passages in the New Testament that seem to talk down against the Torah, it's not saying the Torah is bad. It's pointing out that we are the ones that are weak in keeping God's commandments. And it doesn't matter commandments they are. God can give us a simple commandment like, all right, you can do anything you want, but see that tree over there? Leave that one alone, and we will still go to that tree.
Oh, yeah. Eve couldn't resist it, and neither can we.
And that's why God has given us not only a chance for salvation, but a chance for transformation. That's why he's offering you not only, hey, you know, if you say the right prayer, I will, you know, forgive your sins, give you a clean slate, but also I will not only give you a clean slate, I will put my spirit in you, and I will write my Torah, my teaching, my instructions, my law on your heart. I will cause you to walk in my ways, and I will give you a whole new life, a whole new purpose.
And you know, there's people listening that are filled with emptiness right now, and that's an answer to that, isn't it?
Exactly right. We all seek purpose. I mean, you know, especially guys, I get so fed up with modern evangelical Christianity, which, you know, they wonder, why don't we have any guys showing up for our services? It's all a bunch of women. Well, you know, when your major message is, hey, you can have a relationship with a man who loves you unconditionally.
Sorry. Yeah, that's like me. Whenever they say the bride of Christ, I kind of shrivel. I'm like, I don't want to be no bride.
Well, guys, it's not just that. The Bible does use a lot of bride terminology for it, but you know what? God is calling real men too. He's calling men like Johnny, who is no wuss. He's calling Matthew, who is no wuss. And he's calling you, because a war is coming, not a war of flesh and blood, but a far more important war for the lives and souls of men. And he is calling you to be a warrior in his army. You want a purpose. You want something that will be eternally important, that will never be forgotten. This is your day. This is your recruitment speech right here and now.
Yeah, let's
You start by repenting. You start by being forgiven. You receive God's Spirit. And then you train for war. And believe me, you will see a war.
He will give you peace to fill that mindless, your mind rapidly going down the rapids. He'll give you a peace that passes understanding, peace that doesn't make sense, but yet you will have it. He'll fill all that emptiness if you would just believe that Jesus is God, that he was raised from the dead and he died for your sins, and you will be saved. Confess that with your lips. The Bible says to confess that with your lips. You don't have to confess it in front of somebody else, but if you're able to speak that, just say, Jesus, I believe you're God. I believe that you're raised from the dead. I believe you died for my sins. And you will be saved. And we're coming to the end of the Iron Show session. And so I'd like to give my thank yous up. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, I'd like to thank Dr. Future. I'd like to thank Peter Goodgame for really making the Iron Show what it was. I want to say hey to Gons and Basil. And Leo, if you're listening, Johnny loves you, man. And I'd like to thank Matthew Miller and Rabbi Mike for committing to be here for through this heavy session. And Esther, that is certainly opening my eyes and blessing me. You know, I'm definitely out of this. So come back next week. Keep downloading these sessions. We're going to take them to Esther, and Matthew Miller and Rabbi Mike are going to continue to bless us. I'd like to thank everybody out there on the Fringe Radio Network. I'd like to thank producer Rick. I'd like to thank my hero, Bruce Collins. And I want to thank Derek and Sharon and King Wells. www.endtimetribune.com, and please click on that donate button. Let's help him through the month of March. Johnny loves you.